Hi, my name is Sonal Shah, and I've come here today to the Canon Academy to attend the wildlife photography workshop by Usha Harish.
This is what I thought I will take you through today. How I started, how the transition happened, what is needed for wildlife sightings, then what are the tips which in my experience over the years I gained, then what could be a possible choice of lens or camera which we can, it's not about any brand, but it's about a general outlook of what we need for wildlife, then a little bit of editing aspect. So this was my step of how I moved step by step. First is camera, then is getting used to the camera. You know, it should be like you close your eyes and you can click it. You close your eyes, you can move your shutter dial. Close your eyes, you can change your exposure. So you should first get used to our own, you know, camera. That's extremely important, because in wildlife, nothing waits for you, you know. So unless you do that, you may just miss the chance and it's gone. That's how I learned. There were a lot of mistakes I did, but once you more and more practice, you get used to your camera. Even in your night, you should know that, okay, which is a dial, where you have to do, what you have to press, how you have to, because it's all the way bodies are created. It's a beautiful, you know, way. Yeah, you have a grip, you have your thumb, you have your index finger, these are enough, and this is to stabilize. So that's a simple way to handle a camera and just get used to it. So that was one thing. So I took it like step by step, okay, that is cracked. Now next one is to know about compositions, because that's something only you learn out of looking at the image and then visualizing it. There's so many aspects which come slowly. You look at others' images and understand composition. So then came, and also sharpness. Sharpness in an image is very important. For example, creative shots are always there, you know. Photography is subjective, I do know that. I understand there are a lot of images which can give an excellent way of, you know, appeal to the image, be it wildlife or any other. But sharpness is really required with good focus. So these are the things I started working, and I started stepping out in the wild my own. It's just that observation which helps. So it's just that interest which got created, and I just moved on. So just taking you through some more images which were initially I used to take different parks, and these are the images which I take now. Because of these transition, because of these efforts and learning which started constantly happening. So Amboseli, of course, this is Amboseli National Park. This image, you know, there's a difference between just clicking. There's a difference between you visualizing and then taking a picture. That is the breaking ice for making a good image. It's not about the technical aspects. That you must be always. It's like learning in a kindergarten, you must finish that. But the next step is you visualize what you want. So there were this family, we see a lot of family of elephants in Amboseli. In different ways, they walk horizontal, they walk. So you always see something photographically in terms of patterns, in terms of lines, textures. So once you see and you see the subject in that way, then you know where to position and where to take it. Now this is a three-horned Jackson's chameleon, male chameleon. I was pretty close to the subject, but I loved the bouquet and the colors, which this image was mainly for the colors, because in photography, colors are, even black and white is a color, but colors really fascinate, you know. And when such a chameleon comes, you can't miss it. But the main thing in this picture, which photograph which I wanted to take, was the catchlight coming in the eyes of the chameleon. The light was falling, that's why you could see the sparkle. So some of the wildlife photography tips which I have made in my experience. First and foremost is, please, when you go for a safari, don't oversleep. This is the most essential thing, because you need to get up early, because there are a lot of things which you can see. I will take you through that. I will show you what you will miss if we get up late. 5 o'clock, you should be up and be ready. If you are purely doing wildlife photography, and if you are coming with me, definitely I'll make sure you are all not sleeping at all. So get up, because the magic you get, and we are really, really gifted to be in this equatorial place where the lighting is fantastic when you catch something before sunrise and you catch something after sunset. So the first and foremost should be, you should please early riser and late coming back. The next one is, okay, that's another most important thing is practice patience. I specifically emphasize practice, because you have to practice patience. Reason being, if you don't be patient, there'll be things you can miss out. If you keep moving around, then it may be very difficult. You may not get what you want. So please, that's foremost. There will be a lot of situations where, you know, you may miss the opportunity, but still don't be restless. If you are not getting the image, it's okay, you will get it next time. If you go with that approach, I'm sure you will get something incredible. This is my experience. If you think, you know, you're going on a safari and there is somebody else who says, oh, I saw the cheetah there, but you couldn't see, it's okay. There are so many things to see. It's not just about big cats. There are little things, there are small creatures, you will see. But your idea is to photograph them in a photography way. That is the most important thing. It's not about just seeing the animal. So that's, and nature can never be scripted. I keep telling that every time. It's the most important thing. I probably will keep telling this again and again. Nature can never be scripted. We think something, we go, but we don't get it. It doesn't, because these animals are not posing for us. This is not a captive animal behavior. They are in their animal kingdom. This rule applies to both who are, you know, first time visitors in wildlife, or even who are seasoned photographers. Nature cannot be scripted. So it's our luck if we get it. But understanding animal behavior, we do know that, okay, there could be chances, so we wait. Okay. The third one is, yes, you take lot of pictures. We take lots and lots of pictures. When I started initially, oh my God, I used to just click, take thousands of pictures, but the worst work was coming back and deleting it. That was something which, in a way, in the beginning, yes, that's very important. You need to click, only then you come back, but you need to review all your images. If you're having that patience, then please do it. Today, I don't do that. I don't click. I only wait and then click what I want. And that makes a lot of difference for post-processing. But you need to take pictures, but please get ready to delete also. Don't keep it if it is. But yes, like how I kept some old pictures, please keep it so you will know what I did is, I look at those old pictures and say, oh my God, that's how I used to take. So now I can see that and, you know, be inspired. Oh, wow. Next is animal behavior. You need to know your subject. You definitely need to know your subject, because without knowing that, you will be very restless, you won't be patient. B, just watching them, you learn a lot in the whole process. Now, if you are there for a long time, there could be a lot of things happening with the same animal. You know, it could be a gazelle, it could be an impala, not just a big cat. An impala can do a lot of things. Impala moves, the lighting may change. You can just take some incredible images. It may, if it's in a heat mood, it may mate. you may get a good opportunity to take that, or it may have babies. You just have to, you need to decide what you want to shoot and then you take. Another important thing, please, we need to respect nature and we need to respect animals. It's not a staged one, again. They will not do what we want them to do. So we really need to respect what they can offer, because we are doing this in an open wild area. So we need to be safe as well. There are many instances where we think, you know, we as humans, we think we know a lot of things about everything, but that's not the fact. What probably with our naked eye we are seeing is maybe just 1% of what that wild national park can offer. That park would be infested with animals, with organisms, creatures, crawlies, everything. But we think a big sized animal is, oh, so we are spotted, that's it, okay. That's all the park has, no. So we need to just be safe, not step out in areas which are not designated or not told by the guides. They are the right people to help us out. And we need to respect them. We can't go and, for our photography, you know, ultimately what happens, there's a very fine line between these days, wildlife photography, a good image, how it is taken. There are so many things at the back. You need to know whether are you ethical or you are not. Because when you see the ultimate image, you say, wow, but it could have been that you have disturbed that animal and taken it. But by disturbance, I don't mean that, you know, by disturbance, I would say that, you know, if there is a nesting, a bird nesting, you go, you disturb the nest, take the pictures and then come back and you leave the nest. That is completely disturbed because you have exposed the nest and the bird is vulnerable, the eggs are vulnerable. Those kind of definitely calling out. Sometimes people do animal call or bird call for getting a shot. Those are disturbances, you know. Then you corner an animal and so, honestly speaking, I am not towards it. I don't encourage and I just wait. If it doesn't come, it's fine. I've been glad and I've been fortunate to get some good images. Know your camera and be ready. Now, know your camera I discussed, but be ready is the foremost important thing in wildlife. You know, we have cameras, but if we are not ready at that moment, there is nothing we can come back with. Because that moment has gone. It's really, really, really nature cannot be scripted. So anything can happen anytime. So if you know your camera, you know your body very well, and you are ready with it, with the exact settings, that correlates with the animal behavior. So then it's good. That the next one is, yes, these are once a lifetime opportunity to go to the wild and get that shot. So if you don't back up your images, I'm sorry, we are in deep trouble. And that's another important thing. So if you don't back up your images, I have had experience when I was learning in 2013. I remember I went to Mara. Oh my God, I saw incredible action, migration. I saw chase, kills, everything. I came back. I was backing up my image at that time and my disc got corrupted. So I didn't know what to do. I was literally in tears. And so I came back to Nairobi. I recovered the data, luckily. Then I realized, oh my God, as much as you're clicking, as much as you're taking pictures, backing up is so important. And it's not one backup. You must take minimum two backups in different, you know, ways. Either two hard disk or one cloud, one hard disk. And if you are not able to back up all your 2000 images in one, at least pick some good images which you really want with yourself and back it up. That is something very important. Okay, this is another important thing which I have started following up from last 2-3 years easily, is shoot for yourself, please. Don't shoot for others. You are shooting for yourself. It's your work. You are taking what you visualize, what you want to see, what you want your picture to be. Please do that. If somebody says that, you know, I have a lion yawning, and you may feel, oh my God, I don't have it. But keep it in mind, that's okay. If you get it, you get it. So with that approach, everything looks, you're fine. You're totally happy whenever you go to a safari, because as you more and more think and become restless, oh my God, I didn't get that image. No, it will not work. Whatever you take, be happy and take that picture. Shoot for yourself. It will definitely help you all. Show the habitat. So important. We, in wildlife photography, we have different types of images which we try to take. You know, yes, a big cat is there. We try to take close. We will take close. But just don't stop with that. Because if you have to show to people, where exactly did you see it? Is it in a forested mountain or is it in a deserted plain? You need to show the habitat. Only then, because wildlife photography is not just clicking a photograph. It's about explaining, it's about informing about that animal, where it lives, what it does. So it's all together. So please show the habitat also. Take pictures whenever you take. Take a close-up and take a habitat shot with the animal. So it'll really help. Don't zoom too much, cropping some part. Yeah, that I'll take you through that. Stabilizing is important, depends on how heavy your camera and lens is. Tripod, not all the time for when you're on safari, when you are inside the vehicle, tripod may be challenging. Beanbags definitely help. So if you're going on serious wildlife photography and you have a lens where you cannot manage it, you know, it's not about how many kilos they are, it's about whether you are able to manage it. Because these days you invest in cameras, there are, and lenses, there are image stabilizing everything. But beanbags, I would say that you should have, you know, so that you can stabilize your photograph. Golden lighting, as I said, goes with get up early and get out late. And golden lighting is the magic hour, which I think anything would look great. For me, I personally feel hyenas and warthogs are very ugly, but if you take them in golden lighting, magic. It's magic, you know. it looks stunning. So golden lighting, don't miss that out if you get golden lighting. If you get a cloudy day, you get a diffuse light, which is also, you know, it's an even light, it's great. So that's there. Then black and white images. Also make an effort. Sometimes you can even put your settings into monochrome and take images. But if suppose you are traveling, you're going on a safari, you have a very harsh lighting, you take images. But you can experiment with making it black and white with, you know, editing features. It will really stand up. ISO experiment, yeah. So it depends on what camera you have, how much ISO you can boost up. As I said, you experiment with ISO when you are learning, and you can know is how much, which ISO level you go, you don't have much noise. So you can try that, you can find that out first. But I feel that if you want to take an image and you have waited for a long time, don't miss that out. Boost up your ISO. It's better to take a sharp image than, you know, you feel that noise is less, you reduce your ISO and you get a not so sharp image. You don't have to do that. You increase your ISO. I know ISO is one factor which we all don't want to experiment because we are really scared of it. You know, we won't like to go beyond 1000 maximum. But sometimes, yes, your idea is to get your shutter speed more. So you underexpose the image and then try experimenting. But please, keep it in mind that ISO, don't be, take a risk. Never follow an animal. Please be ahead of it. That will come when you are tuned to wildlife, when you are going in animal, when you understand the animal behavior, and when you have a good guide with you whose instincts work very well. If we follow an animal, what happens is the animal gets scared. The animal is restless. The animal doesn't do, it's not in its natural surroundings, not in your normal behavior. So you be discreet about what you're doing. So you don't follow an animal, chase an animal. Chase, it's not chase, it's follow. Don't follow an animal, but just think ahead and just position or station yourself. The animal will be normal because you're not moving around. You're not, showing any signs that you are disturbing or making that animal or bird restless. If you want to go close to the animal, look distracted, yeah. So don't please give attention to the animal that I'm coming. If you want to take a photograph, just look normal. Like this, I'll tell you examples when I've gone for gorilla training, you know, what was the experience on all that. Creativity, yes, as I said, fast shutter, it's always good, but slow shutter is definitely, you can experiment and get some wonderful images. So these are some of the tips which I thought of sharing. I hope it was useful. I would love to take a feedback. Some of the composition tips which has really helped me. And so look for the textures, patterns, lines, wherever it is. Please don't skip that, because that makes or breaks an image. It's so important. Where do you place the subject? How do you visualize the whole scene? Angles, you can get in the eye level. Today, in today's photography, things have changed even in wildlife. Angles, it's just not eye level. People, the trends are changing. It's going low angle shot, top angle shot. But eye level, as humans, we are tuned to that kind of a composition. Whatever we are doing is what our eyes are seeing in everyday life. So today I'm seeing something, I like this because my eye level, I'm getting this image. So whatever it is, eye level will always be nice. Get creative sometimes, yeah. It's not easy to position, it's wildlife, safari. We may not be able to position where we want or where the others are taking. So we need to get creative. If we are not getting that kind of an image, it's okay. You just be creative on what you can do, what you can probably get out of that particular position. Because we cannot give an excuse saying that, oh my God, I was in a wrong position and I didn't get that image. If you're not happy with that image, it's not something which probably we should have with us. Different angles, yes. You can make a story in an image, because in wildlife, it's just not a picture. It is, you are actually seeing the whole scene unfold and then you are getting the image, you know. So you can do a lovely story from all the images, whatever you have taken. I will take you through my images, so probably you can get glimpses of what I have shown here. Look in space, rule of thirds, classic. A basic composition rule which never fails is rule of thirds, placing the subject where you are, where you want to place. So for example, even in this image, it is the same. So actually in this image, you can see the line, the you know, where the subject is placed. You have given I've given a space to the whole scene. So rule of thirds is always good. AF points, you know, we have these AF points in our camera. It could be 9 or it could be even more than that, depending on the camera. Yeah, Rahim. Hi, how are you? So most of the time I use aperture mode. You know, manual, focus. Focus, I use autofocus, yes. I use autofocus, but most of the time I use a spot AF. But it depends. If I am, in my experience, what has happened of late is, if there's a big cat action or there's a bird flying, the camera is sophisticated to give more. There are different zones in the camera, so sometimes I use a zone AF. You know, spot AF I use mainly for stationary subjects. You know, where I can decide where the eye has to, where I have to keep my focus point to the eye of the animal. Depends on the animal. Big animals you cannot, so small animals you can move your focus point to the eye. But if it is an ostrich, if it is a giraffe, it's not about go to the eye, because we may not be as, I definitely am not tall as giraffe, so I definitely cannot take that. So then it's okay. It's a different thing. It's a different setting you do. It's okay, Rahim? Yeah, okay. So use AF points for composition, use viewfinder, yeah. So you see from the viewfinder what image you want to take. You first compose it in the viewfinder, then you move your AF points. That's what I wanted to tell. Use center AF point, yeah. Environmental image, more with habitat. Framing inside a frame. Sometimes an image becomes very appealing, like there is a frame and then so it's like lines are there and then you place, then watch your background. Oh my god, that's extremely important. When you are taking a picture, it's not that subject. You are seeing in the viewfinder the whole composition. So you need to see whether the background is also okay or not. Whether the background has a distraction or not. Now in this particular thing, if there I had something here, it will be a big distraction for this lion. Because our eye, and especially if that background is in the rule of thirds, you know, if the background is somewhere here, I would have been focusing in this lion, I would have not seen that background, then I don't think so it would be appealing. That's my view. You know, there are different situations. Situations change. In sometimes that may not look like a distraction, but in many, many occasions, distraction happens. Like for example, you are seeing a bird flying, you are waiting, all your settings are ready, you are seeing a bird flying. You wouldn't have realized there could have been something bad in the sky which has come. That is a distraction, a clear distraction. So please watch your background with and no distraction. So these are some of the composition tips I feel would definitely help in wildlife photography. I'll take you through my images and talk about it, and we'll go through that. As I mentioned, you know, there's a lion on the Cobb Jay and clouds are at the background. So this is taken in Serengeti, you know, just to show how the elephants are in Serengeti, because there are a lot of Cobb Jays there and he was nicely resting. Now you see, this is not a great morning light, okay? But because you see the lion is resting and it's harsh light, but still I felt that there is a story, because you can show what the lion is doing. It's in its own peaceful place. That's the place where they are, and the clouds add a drama to the image at the backdrop. So yeah, and so I thought wide angle would definitely help it out. These are, I'm sure many people would have or would love to take an image like where the amboseli, this is a quintessential amboseli where you see the Mount Kilimanjaro and the full family of elephants. I got a chance. Again, if you notice lines, never skip or make any mistake on the lines, because this is a basic thing which we all tend to do, because we don't compose knowing the background. So next time when you please go, just check, keep your backgrounds clear. It's nothing cropped, it's just the way it is, because these elephants were nicely moving up in a bunch and Kilimanjaro was nicely giving the pose there. Migration. Now this is migration. It's a wildebeest coming in a line. So wait for what happens. You know, you get a line, but getting the S. So this is, it's just visualize and say that, okay, I need to take this. I don't want to skip any of these S. And there's one wildebeest which is my mating also, in fact. So keep the line straight again. I divided this photograph in two, if you see 50%. So that helps, like the line, the horizon line is almost dividing the image into two parts. So the reason it is appealing, I feel, is because of certain things. So if I had kept this line a little more up and left the sky a bit less, I feel it could have been a, you know, a different image, but you would give more focus on the ground and the sky. So open up the sky a bit, because there are mountains there. So take an image when you visualize. It really makes a difference. That's again a habitat shot. Again, you see the same kind of pattern. But what's important in this image, which probably adds a factor to it, is that tree. You know, because the tree is A, very dramatic. It's not a straight tree. It's a very slanting, nicely posed tree. So the tree is giving a lot of character. I was sitting there, it was really very hot, and there was nothing to take in this image, actually, honestly, because the lion is sleeping there, you know. So I was thinking, okay, this is of no use, but let's wait. And then the lion was, I just thought, okay, the only composition I can do at that time is this. So I changed my lens, put to wide angle, and the lion lifted the head, so something came out. But the whole scene was because of the clouds and the tree. It could be any animal there. The animal is not the main highlight, but animal makes a difference because it's wildlife. Birds. Fast action. Carmine bee eater is really, really very small bird. You know, it is nicely magnified, but it's actually a very little bird. I took this in 100-400 lens. So after my Canon 60D 7300, I went for a full frame, and 5D Mark III was my first camera into it with a 100-400. So I understood that, okay, maybe you should go closer to the subject and probably take some images. So by my restriction, yes, was when I had my 60D, I had a crop factor. So with my 100-400, I can go 640, black and white. Please go black and white. Try to change it to monochrome and see what best you can bring. Wildebeest running in panic, dust creating. So black and white image. You can black and whites. I usually probably work on little more editing. You know, blacks and whites. Reduce the highlights if it is harsh. This is another pattern which you go for, zebras. So they were fighting, but you know, I just wanted to compose it this way, where they were synchronized and moving around. This is like an environmental image where, you know, it's kind of an artistic image. So many branches and trees giving that dramatic effect, and the leopard is there. So when you go and, you know, when you see such sight, we tend to take closer pictures of the leopard on the tree. But that's an image, you know, that's an image. It's a great image, it's a leopard. But try to look beyond that, look around and see. This is because of these, you know, maze which is bringing out. So this is what I just wanted to show you, how the slow and fast shutter will happen. Again, twilight, zebras. So that's slow shutter, you know, it's in the center. So composition wise, it's in the center both, but you can see the blurred effect on the giraffe. And this, you can see the stationary subject. There you can see that it's moving with that. So creative, or you can work around with your shutter when you are taking. This is from top view. This is up in a hill, so it just happened that the flamingos were still water and they were giving the reflections. Now this is the eye level. You have seen most of my images are eye level, but again, you see this is the kind of when flamingos fly without panic, they fly like this, otherwise they'll just flutter. Foreground blur, experiment, you know. Sometimes that's also a image. Don't think that there is some image in the, but in the front and that is blurred, and the background. Our eyes are tuned to see the front image always, but in these certain situations, you can go with a background blur, foreground blur. This is another beautiful story. So the lions were mating, and They were mating, they were happily sitting there, and suddenly elephants came. Those elephants wanted to act, they didn't want to disturb the lion. They actually wanted to come to the place where there were a lot of food for them. So they see the, then they got agitated, they started chasing away. Now, the beautiful behavior which I learned out of that was the lion go towards the elephant. The lion was going behind the female, you know, because they were in a mating mode. And that was surprising to me. I thought, you learn every time when you go, that was, I thought, oh, maybe the lion and the elephant may start, you know. But no, he was just following, and this female is not happy at all with the lion. You see this, then that elephant is not leaving, chasing, the lion is following her. Lion is still following only the lioness. And then they move, they sit in another position, and then they mate. So the story ends with mating, with all the scene inside going through. Next is, what can be the possible way to choose a camera or lens for wildlife? You know, this is basic thing you need for a camera. You definitely need decent frames per second, because if you go with 3 frames, 4 frames, you can take, I'm not saying, you can take a portrait, you can do all that, but if you have to take a fast action, frames are required. So it all depends on our budget, how much we can invest, how much we can take. Whatever it is, you can work it out, but these are basic things which I feel, low light capabilities, you know, ISO capabilities, autofocus point, that is also important. In wildlife, things sometimes move very fast. Lens, again, you know, you should, when you get a lens, see what is the minimum focusing distance, because sometimes you can even take a macro shot from the lens you have. Specs, in specs, you can check it up. Focal length is, there's no end to focal length, as I said, so it is your call how, you know, but for wildlife, that is important. Fast aperture, yes. Now, the major thing is how heavy that lens is for you to manage. And please, when you get a lens, just take when you are ready for it. Don't, you know, it's not about the magic of prime. We say it is a good, great prime lens, but lugging around and using it is also not that easy. So, which you are comfortable with, you should invest first. 100, 400, if you are happy, please, it's a great lens. It's a great lens to take for wildlife. Ultimately, what is our aim is to take that image. It's not about what, where, how, you know, but so check how heavy and can you manage. Keep your editing natural. Don't skip editing. Editing is a very important tool. It's not that you, please do it, but don't do it to an extent that it looks really, is that really true? There will be some workshop coming up in a couple of months, and July also. So please check out, I'll definitely inform when the dates are open. It'll be wonderful, you know, I prefer this is theoretical, but practically what you take, and it's you who are going to take it. I can only tell, or I'm just telling out of my experience, but I'm so glad today I'm standing here and sharing with you what each one of you go through. That's exactly what I went through and I have come up. So I am extremely happy to show my images, to talk about it. I just feel, you know, this is a great forum. If even little bit of inspiration you have got, that you will shoot next time with something targeted in mind, I would be glad. Please do that, you know. I hope it was, the workshop was, the talk was useful. Please give me feedback. Thank you.
Today I attended this session or this workshop by Usha Harish Photography, concerning the whole concept or the whole topic on wildlife. Currently in the country there's no much established photography in wildlife, and for me that was something I really wanted to know, how it is interacting with animals, considering the fact that some animals are crazy.
We got to learn quite a few things on how to take your photos, what kind of composition to follow, what are the kind of settings you can be using in different kind of scenarios, the kind of behaviors you expected to follow during your visit to national parks or national reserves. when are the best times for photography, what... Okay, there was quite a lot to learn about.
This was a very well arranged workshop. It was a very good combination of technical, of what to do exactly when you're on a wildlife safari journey, and composition, as well as Usha's own journey through bad to good to even better photos.
Thank you to Cameras Kenya, Photographers Association of Kenya, and Canon for organizing this wonderful workshop. I'm a dentist by profession, but love taking photos, whether it be wildlife, landscapes, people, and it's always good to learn. I mean, I'm more of what I'd say a beginner or an amateur. Usha provided a really good overview of her journey in taking photographs, in explaining that don't get disheartened when you have 100 bad images and only one good one, that's part of the process. She talked through a lot of the technicalities, although didn't make it too technical for today, and I think hopefully that will be done later, and I'm hoping there's more workshops where they show us that on the field.
A big thank you to Usha Harish for coming here. A big thank you to Canon for organizing this workshop, as well as Photographers Association of Kenya and Cameras Africa.